So first up on our agenda is the public hearing for associate membership zoning change, public hearing. So Nick, if you wouldn't mind reading the legal notice.
Pursuant to Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 40A, Section 5, Adoption or Change of Zoning Ordinances or Bylaw. Notice is hereby given that the Reading Community Planning and Development Commission, CPDC, will hold a public hearing on Monday, October 5th, 2015, at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room of the Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to discuss the proposed zoning amendments to include a new section 4.3.3 to allow for one associate membership on the CPDC, and the new section 4.5.3 to allow for two associate memberships on the Zoning Board of Appeals. Complete text relative to the proposed amendments and more information are available for public inspection between 7:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m. Monday through Thursday and until 7 p.m. on Tuesdays in the Public Services Department of Reading Town Hall.
Great, thank you.
So Gene, I know there's a little bit of history that kind of brought us to this point. You want to just provide a brief recap of that, and then we can discuss it amongst the board and open up for public comment?
Sure. The initial conversation about this happened when the Charter Review Committee was working, and they thought about including this, and they did include a provision, a very broad provision, in the charter. It was then decided by town council that the detail of it really belonged in the general bylaw. And so that was voted on at town meeting, at the annual town meeting this past year. And the attorney general wrote back and said that wasn't allowed per the Zoning Act. So it needs to be in zoning. Both the reference to associate members for CPDC and Zoning Board of Appeals, which is why it's back here.
So the content and the regulation itself, it seems like town meeting was fine with. It's just getting it back into its place to satisfy
the statute,
the
really.
Statute, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, and limiting it to a single associate member for,
yeah,
the, for the CPDC.
That's right, okay. And then two for ZBA, right?
Correct.
Okay.
And that single for CBDC was, comes from
40A.
From 40A?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. Any questions or comments on any of the language or,
well,
I think we've already kind of approved it or for inclusion on the warrant.
The, when I flipped open my November 2014 zoning bylaw, there's a numbering error, appears to be, in the section 4.3. It goes 4.3, 4.3.1, 4.3.1.1, and then 4.3.2.2. And so on, down to 4.3.2.6. So there isn't, there doesn't seem to be an explicit section 4.3.2. And there's not a section 4.3, new section 4.5.3, let's see. 4.5.3 is okay, because we don't have an existing one. But we've got some numbering.
4.4?
Hmm?
We have a 4.4 section and sub paragraphs?
Yes.
And those would still exist if we corrected the other error?
Yes.
Okay.
The, I mean, 4.3.1 is basically the CPDC, the powers. And it, well, take a look. I mean, it's right up there.
The way I read it is it was going at the end of 4.3.2.6 as 4.3.3.
Yeah, but 4.3.2.6 is properly numbered 4.3.1.6.
So this would be either 4.3.3, which would be okay, or it has to be 4.3. it has to be either 4.3.3 or 4.3.1.7.
Are you sure it's not an indent problem?
Well.
Page 19.
Well, the question I have, since you brought that up, is where does it, here we're adding a section about the associate membership and who, what they do and how long they are, but I don't see in here anything about the regular members, how many there are, what their terms are, at least not in this section.
Is it because they're the bylaw references chapter 48? Under 4.3.1, that CBDC shall act on matters in this jurisdiction. It keeps referring to chapter 48. Yeah, because I remember we spent a lot of time on this on the Zoning Advisory Committee. Should we include things? Shouldn't we? And I thought what we came back to is that the statute was, it was better to just reference the statute.
Mm-hmm. So what's the issue right now? Is it the numbering or?
Well, I think we have to fix the numbering.
I don't know if we can go back to anything outside of this. If there's a numbering problem that's outside of the four corners of this,
okay.
What I thought this was is adding it at the end, 4.3.3. But if to touch anything else,
okay.
And can we do that? Can we just add it in without overwriting something else?
Or? Yep. I mean,
that's probably a good thing to come back to.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with the, adding 4.3.3 and 4.3.4. Or I'm sorry, 4.3.3 and 4.5.3.
4.5.3.
Zoning Board of Appeals is 4.5.
Right.
Do we have like a list of ongoing maintenance items that we identify that we can?
We are keeping a list.
Yeah. Maybe we should throw that
in
there.
Please,
yeah.
Add this one to the list, please.
Okay.
Fix the numbering.
And I'm curious to know if there's anything explicit in the makeup of the organization, it's, or the body itself that John was referencing, or if it's strictly pointing to 40A as
yeah.
That's how you should design the body.
Okay.
I'm just curious.
Well, the Home Rule Charter has references to the, you know, creation of the bodies.
Yeah, you're right.
Charter.
And that's where this gets confusing. It's like,
yeah.
Oh, that's in there, but then they're telling us to move the associate memberships in here?
That specifically comes out of the 40A.
Yeah, all right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the charter, section 4.5 in the Home Rule Charter, says CPDC consisting of 5 members appointed by the Board of Selectmen for 3-year terms.
All right, so there it is.
So that's the structure of it is defined in the charter. But the Attorney General has told us that the associate membership has to be a zoning law, so it falls under the 40A, I guess.
Okay, strange, but be that as it may.
We didn't
go
write
somewhere
this
else.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, that was the only thing that I noticed. The rest of it looks fine.
How about you, Nick? You okay with it? John?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah, I am as well. Anyone from the public have any comments or questions on the proposed amendment to our zoning bylaw?
Oh.
Okay. We'll start with our beloved associate member himself.
I have been an associate member, I think, about 10 years, but I have not fulfilled the apparent voice of an associate member, which is to prep. I'm not full membership, in full membership. And now I feel that as the roster is limited by one more seat, so I think that the role of the associate member and the intent should act, should be more aligned with potential full membership. So my intent as an associate member is to encourage new people to come in, to let the youth appear and help in the boards and commissions and committees. So I would, I would encourage others to appear, and my intent is to resign as an associate member until that moment that someone appears and volunteers for this position with the intent of fulfilling the actual purpose of this position. I'll be, you will not get rid of me, I will be here to help you on technical matters.
We like knowing that we can
absolutely
use you in that capacity. Thank you. Okay, thank you, George. Hello.
Good evening. Hello, Tony DeRezzo, 130 John Street. First, I would like to thank George for all his years. He has done a lot of work.
He sure has.
I've watched him do it. He's been very knowledgeable. And I know it goes that I shouldn't have to ask this question, but I'm going to anyhow. There's no pending litigation that this amendment will resolve, is there?
Not to our knowledge.
Not that we're aware of. No, this came back from the previous review of the Home Rule Charter, where the Attorney General told us that we can't have this in our Home Rule Charter. It has to be in our zoning bylaw. So
well,
we're simply cleaning that up.
Yeah, it was actually, I mean, the I think it was the general bylaw update.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Rather.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
I mean, the charter was approved, but the most recent update to the general bylaws, which included the details of the associate membership, the particular aspect of it got bounced by the AG.
To answer your question, no, this does not touch upon any pending litigation.
Just checking. Turns out I have to check now.
Yes.
Yes. Anybody else have any questions regarding the zoning bylaw change? Okay.
Move that we close the public hearing for the proposed amendment to the zoning bylaw relative to associate membership for CPDC.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move that we recommend adoption of the zoning bylaw amendment for sections 433 and 453 of the zoning bylaw.
All those in favor? Excellent. You folks are here for Bill Moore in Maine, right?
Correct.
Okay. Do we have somebody here from Shell?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I saw people outside. I looked right through you. My apologies. All right. Excellent. Next up on the agenda, modification to master signage plan for 87 Walker's Brook Drive, the Shell Station. And Gene, if you wouldn't mind providing just a brief overview, and then we'll give you an opportunity to present the changes. Thank you.
Sure. What you have before you is a request to modify the master signage plan. So this is the Shell Station on 87 Walker's Brook. The freestanding sign is being proposed to have some alterations to the actual pole structure, some new paint and the like. They're proposing new LED illuminated price panels, and they're proposing a new internally illuminated Dunkin' Donuts sign panel with a white background, and a new, they call it a Shell Pectin sign panel, the clamshell. So that's on the freestanding sign. And then they're also calling out some additional signage on the canopy. I believe there are two signs, these clamshells, I call them clamshells, likewise, they're looking to do some color treatment. The red now will be proposed to be illuminated on the canopy. And so that's more or less what it looks like. If I get that right, the red stripe now is illuminated. The yellow is the same.
Correct.
Okay. And then so that's what the wall sign looks like. The gasoline pumps are also being proposed to have LED toppers. Basically it.
Okay. Anything you'd like to add? Go right ahead.
Just the fact that, again, we're looking to modify the existing signage in keeping with sort of the new shell retail visual image upgrade, which includes the refacing of the ID sign, modifications to the canopy, and ultimately, I believe we still have to go before the Zoning Board of Appeals to get a variance to allow us to do the LED price sign, as well as the pump toppers, and also the variance to the two canopy signs, our additional wall signs. So we will be seeking from ZBA for that.
Okay, great. And for the record, we might just.
Oh, my name is Steve Pedro with AUB Engineering.
Okay, great.
Consultants to Maria Energy.
Perfect. Thank you. So, yeah, for the purposes of this meeting tonight, we're talking about really the freestanding sign, both the shell and the Dunkin' Donuts.
I think the point of having this before you is to get the approval of the overall master signage plan with these changes, and however you want to handle that, but I think the way I drafted the decision, it would be conditioning that approval of the master signage plan on any of the zoning requirements that are needed from the Zoning Board of Appeals. So just calling that out so that it doesn't appear to be a blanket approval from this board.
Okay. What questions do we have?
Okay. I'm telling you right now that I'm opposed to the LED band around the canopy and the extra signs on the canopy. I don't understand this at all. So this is such an iconic emblem that there has to be two of them 30 feet apart, otherwise no one knows which gas station this is. That's brilliant. That's ridiculous. And there's another one on the other side of the canopy too?
That's correct.
Which can't be seen because of the tree canopy behind it. So that's a good place to put it too. We've done the LED toppers before, as long as they don't blink. I think we've all pretty much agreed to start allowing those on the pumps.
But did those have to still need to go through?
Still need to get a variance, but I think what we've always done is made a recommendation, and then ZBA looks at that.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's a danger in lighting this canopy the way they want to light it, because we have other canopies in more sensitive areas, and they'll just use this as a basis to bypass zoning again. So I don't think it's a good idea. I don't have a problem with coloring it if it's not already painted. Is it already yellow?
Yeah, it is already.
The only modification we have to the canopy right now is we add white to the canopy. Right now it's just yellow with the red band. As you can see, the rendering head is a white border at the top.
Yeah, man. Don't have a problem with changing the colors to be brand colors on the canopy, but I would have a problem with adding that shell. And I have a problem with the LED lights around.
If I could just jump in too, I discussed it with the building inspector, and he felt that once that red LED illuminated panel went in, that he would classify it as signage, the whole canopy.
The LED
the red band went in, the building inspector felt as though that whole canopy should be treated as signage.
Yeah, that's been his opinion, and in the past, we were okay with them adding color to that, which were brand colors.
Right.
But there's no signage on them. We gave them the choice of either putting it on the canopy or on the freestanding sign. And the ZBA went with that. There's plenty of other branding. And there's little shells all over the pumps. There's little shells all over every little item in there. It's clear whose gas station this is.
The other thing I noticed on the diagram, the 2.2.2, which has the nighttime picture of the pectin panel and the illuminated stripe. The illuminated stripe is also splashing light onto the yellow band in this particular picture. So it's hard to imagine that this thing would be anything resembling dark sky compliant. I'm not sure if this particular picture is representative of what they're actually proposing. It would appear to be. And I agree with Nick that it's first off unnecessary. I mean, it's not a matter of distinguishing yourself between any adjacent gas station,
mm-hmm.
because there aren't any.
Yeah. Kind of goes against what we're trying to prevent, just an influx of signs.
They also have the highway sign, right? Does
yeah.
this gas station have that 60-footer?
Now, for the freestanding sign, are there any questions or concerns about those changes?
Well, I couldn't read the smaller type of the existing price, so I'm not sure I understand the need for the 3-foot-tall LED numbers. But other than that, it's... I don't know if we have a lumen guideline or limit on such things.
Well, doesn't the the way the sign bylaw reads is that these are either called reader boards or LEDs or both, which are both prohibited?
Thought we allowed it for gas stations.
Well, it says board. Yeah, I guess so. It's
and then in the
except
PUDI,
as price displays for gas stations.
In PUDI, there's some additional signage that calls out that says that these. J signs allowed, 826, H and J are allowed. So I don't know if that fixes it.
Do we know how large that price sign is, the actual LED portion of it?
I believe the diesel, the green, is 12 inches in height, and I believe the regular, the red is 16 to 17, 1 foot high.
good distance to 95. So if you're coming from that direction before you get onto 95, you could see the sign and clearly decide whether you want to go there. I think that's the point of this gas station.
Sure.
Okay, everything else looks like it makes sense. It's dark backgrounds and illuminated graphics. And this is only going to display the regular price, so it won't be changing regularly.
The only time it will change is when the actual product price changes.
Okay.
Can we, should we condition? Here's my concern, is there are other gas stations that are changing their price on a, according to who drives up to the pump, or they have two different prices and they're flashing them back and forth between between one and the other. So I wouldn't want a, I think we need to, if the expectation is that it's going to be a LED sign and it's only going to change when the price changes, probably rarely more than once a day, then that should be included in
here. Yeah, I would agree.
I thought we had language in the code about how often an LED sign could change.
Yeah, but it's the...
the exemption, it would get a little bit quirky with this because we say that because of this exclusion for price signage for gas stations.
No, we can add as many conditions as you want. I was just looking for language. But the pump toppers, we had some language last time. I think we said that they would not change for those reasons, for club membership, whatever discount pricing. It's single price.
Last time we talked about this was Cumberland Farms, right? Do we know what language was put in there?
Was it Cumberland Farms or was it the one on Main and South?
Yeah, Cumberland came in after them, and that's why we were aware that the South and Main one is blanking.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
So I don't know if we want to reference that language, if that worked, or... So I can make us dig that up right now, but that might be effective. So when we put something in there for that.
Check.
Sorry, I'm going to put you on the spot.
So while she's looking, I have another sort of oddball one. Is that in terms of height, I know it's the existing pole. Right? I mean, you're not going to change a pole. The only notation on here is the elevation of the pole. I don't know if that's absolute elevation or if that means that the pole, in fact, is 25 feet high.
The actual pole is a grade difference between the two poles.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I think we identified 25 feet
as the higher of the, So the max sign height is in this district is 20 feet. I don't know how you deal with that, whether because they're changing, it's a dramatic change to the, they're changing the sign, they're not changing the poles, but it's the sign height is higher than the maximum allowed in the zoning district.
Did they get a variance? No.
And I guess not.
All right, let's come back to that. Gene Dewar. It's probably, we don't need to search for this for too long. Just figured it might be a good, for the sake of consistency.
Just to clarify the sign structure, modify the poles at all. It's purely a refacing, a new sort of cabinets within that structure.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Paint the poles, but other than that, that's it structural.
So from a, I'm going to say completely administrative and bureaucratic perspective, it's hard to approve a sign structure that that doesn't fit with zoning. So I think we need to make sure that we account for it in some way or shape or form. I don't think this board has ever.
I'm not sure that 25 feet, if it's from a higher
right
grade or if it's a lower grade. If it's a lower grade, then at
maybe
the high
it
grade,
is.
Probably conforming.
Yeah.
That slope condition out there.
Understood. I was corrected. There's an exclusion of LEDs on signs in general, or a prohibition of LEDs and signs in general. Gas station pricing signs are exempt from that prohibition.
So they're allowed. Right?
They're allowed. Yeah, they're allowed per the right. Per the zoning. Yes.
So then I would be going to the zoning board of appeals for the.
Just the toppers. Well, and the other question that it says in the bylaw is that in conformance with state regulations.
Yeah, I was going to say the pump toppers, we're required by law to post the price on top of the dispenser.
Right.
It doesn't have to be electronic.
It does not.
No.
But that's my question is, so, but gasoline stations.
No, just this one. Just your freestanding.
Oh, just the freestanding side. Okay.
Right. Because that's what
we're
doing.
I haven't met with Mr. Redman yet to go over our ZBA application and, you know, the idea of the total canopy being considered a sign now, so I'm just trying to get my background. Thank you.
Well, I mean, if you, I guess you could still pursue it, but if you don't add the illuminated band around the canopy.
Right.
And only make the color changes and don't add the two little shells, there's no variance required on the canopy. And there'd be no variance required on the standing sign unless you are over the height and never got.
Well, that makes sense. Yeah.
Permission to put that one in.
Hmm.
Just for the pump toppers.
Does Cumberland Farms have their
well,
sign?
Well, there's no change to the height.
LED?
There's no change to the height, but if it's not never been approved, and it's in violation?
Somewhere in the bylaw that I can't find is the special allowance for businesses within 150 feet of the highway right away.
Yeah, that's in the PUD section.
Yeah, and the big tall, the ones that allow the Home Depot and Jordan's.
He's not 150 feet within the right away. The property next door is probably 150 feet, and that's probably 25 feet from the right of way.
Yeah.
Think of the frontage on the building next door, right? That's it. It's at least 150 feet.
You mean without a map or plan?
Yeah, no, I'd want to see it on a map, but it just
right.
Seems, you know, unless the right of way is in the middle of the property.
Well, I presume that what they have currently was approved by somebody at some point.
Or not. Wouldn't be the first time somebody put a sign up without paying attention to what it was supposed to be, or lighting, for that matter.
Well, I would be surprised in this particular case, because we've had so much attention with the Honda Gallery and the, all of the other stuff going on in that same area. I mean, I'm willing to let him slide on that particular one, in exchange for getting rid of the illuminated band on the canopy.
Well, that's the strategy nowadays, is to come in with 20 signs and lights and whittle it down to what you really want. Make you think you gave something up. I'm okay with that height, I'm just, but John's right. If we're continually approving a sign that doesn't comply, then you resolve that at some point.
We don't even know if this doesn't comply, right? You're not sure where that measurement is based on.
I'm not sure if it's 25 feet from the lowest grade, which then the highest point is, maybe in compliance, or even if there was a variance for that. That's why I don't know.
Right. There's two questions that we can't necessarily answer.
Well.
Yeah.
How do we progress this one way or the other?
Gene, I don't know.
I think I can find it.
That's fine. For this Cumberland Farms language.
Either four signs are not allowed, are exempt.
Mm-hmm.
Are not allowed except for press displays. It doesn't say anything about exemption about LEDs. The sign on which the message changes more than 8 times per day shall be considered an ambient or electronic sign.
Okay, so we categorize this as a reader board.
But still, I don't see anywhere in here about the exemption for LED.
Exemption for LED? I thought it was just an exemption for illuminated price display.
There's an exemption for price displays. Because they're considered reader boards.
Okay.
That's it. That's all I can find. Unless Gene.
No, that's.
It's fuel pump information signs, only as required by state law, are allowed and shall not affect the computation of allowable number of signs or aggregate sign size on a property. That's number G.
Okay. The
exemption.
What do you see, Dave? Anything?
Page 67 of the zoning bylaw, section 8266. Designs in industrial zoning districts. It says the CPDC may allow one additional freestanding sign not to exceed 35 feet in height or 144 square feet in sign area in that portion of the PUD parcel's landscaped perimeter buffer area most closely adjacent to Route 128. But not closer than 500 feet from any other public street existing at the time of submission of a relevant preliminary PUD plan.
Wow.
It's
all right, well, I guess we're good then.
So 35 feet is probably okay.
Okay. So we're okay with the height. Thank you for bearing with us. All right, so let's move this forward. I think we're good on, it sounds like we're good on the height. I think what started this was the conversation about adding a condition regarding how frequently or infrequently the pump toppers can change. And then I took us down that rabbit hole of trying to find something in a previous approval. Let's not keep searching for that and just develop something here.
Did we say there are 8 times a day, not more than 8 times a day?
Well, it's called, it's defined as a reader board if it changes more than 8 times a day.
No, animated reader board or animated sign?
No, I think it was animated.
A reader board. A sign on which the message changes more than 8 times a day per day. Oh, I'm sorry, yeah, it shall be considered animated or electronic.
So tech, does that mean that they can change it 7 times a day unless we condition it otherwise?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
You don't notice that, though. It's not that.
That's true.
It's just change it once. You're not going to change it 7 times in a row.
Right.
I guess they could. Okay. So is that going to apply to the toppers as well?
I think that's
yes.
All we can apply it to, right? And for the purposes of this application?
I think they're both.
John doesn't think the other one.
I think they're both the same.
Oh, I see. Yep. You're right. You're right.
So I think we need to write it that way just to be safe.
I don't see where they're exempt from, I mean, the prohibition on LED signs.
Well, the prohibition isn't on LED signs, it's on illuminated signs. Or it can't just be LEDs, we wouldn't have just written it for LEDs.
Right, any self-illuminated or backlit signs which use LCD, LED, electronic messaging, digital technology, or similar.
Yeah, so you're better off applying for both of them, just in case.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, are we able to turn our attention to the decision?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, did you want to take comments from?
Oh yeah, that's true. Any comments from the public on these changes? Yes, Tony.
Tony DeRozzo, 130 John Street. First, I don't believe this property is a PUD. Isn't the definition of PUD at least 3 acres or 3 or 5 acres, and the applicant actually has to apply for it? It's not just granted as a PUD.
Yeah, I don't think that he's in a PUD.
But it is in the industrial zone.
It's in the
industrial zone, but not a PUD.
Which means the signage height of 35 feet in a PUD doesn't apply in this case.
Okay. Do we have a
pull up the sign map?
Zone map.
I'll pull it up on the screen, David.
Well,
so the PUDI extends.
Across, all the way across the.
Yeah, it's covered.
That's an overlay district that I thought had to be applied for, but it's not automatically granted.
The overlay zoning would be available.
Correct.
But this wasn't.
Yeah.
So the question is, how tall was the original master signage plan signage? Because I have that here. If the original master signage plan, in my opinion, allowed it, then it's already been decided.
And I would
this
agree
is just
that.
Now being amended.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep.
Yeah, I think Tony's objection was that we were citing a PUD language height not be applicable.
Right.
Which may not be, yeah.
And I would not want the applicant to come back and go, well, I can put up a 35-foot high sign based on that information.
Yeah.
Right. Are you pulling up the previous master signage plan?
I do have the master signage plan. That was from June. No, this was the one.
Mr. Chairman, my concern is not with, I think the sign as is acceptable. I'm just concerned that if the applicant tries to add another 10 or 15.
Sure, no, I understand.
So if it wasn't part of the, if it wasn't approved already as part of the master signage plan, the height of it, then as you're going to ZBA to get your LED, then what you'd need to do is get ask for that added height on.
And again, I'm not even sure. You'd have to go out there.
Right, and it may, yeah.
Doesn't seem like we're gonna be able
no.
to get this information.
Yeah.
This was the original set of plans that the CPTC approved in June of 2013.
Right, that was with the Dunkin' Donuts.
But something was approved before then, right? Or, well, not necessarily. Never mind. What does that say? No, they don't reference the height.
It must have been on the application.
Were those new, was that a new sign? Is this a new sign as of like 2 or 3 years ago?
Yeah.
This has been the same sign that's been there for
forever.
For 20 years, yeah.
Yeah.
So.
And I did speak to the building inspector about this, and he will go over this with a fine-tooth comb because we spent a lot of time on this.
So just call that to his attention, if you wouldn't mind. We may need to package that into your...
Once I meet with him to go over the zoning Board of Appeals application, we can address that. You should be included for the zoning board.
You would need to,
for the height. We've identified it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, it was left blank on this initial application back in June of 2013, the height.
I think the reason is because of that grade differential was quite steep.
Right.
Yeah.
If you take an average of it,
we have that in here.
It's in the bylaw. I forget the formula off the top of my head, but it's in there. Tony?
Based on the sign of the normal grade.
Yeah, it's normal grade, and if normal grade cannot be determined, then it is the grade of the nearest public road.
Okay. Okay. Do we need to add that as a potential finding, or because we're unsure if it's an issue or not? And I see we've got a call out of ZBA relief.
Mm-hmm.
SG2 listed as a...
Yeah, I think 5C in the findings should be SG2.
Oh, yeah, I picked that up this afternoon.
Okay.
SG2 and SG3.
Yeah. To my previous question, do we want to add that as a... add the height as a potential item for the ZBA?
I would have just add a condition that says that if it can't be determined that the 25 feet was previously permitted, it shall be applied for in the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Okay.
Or something like that.
Yeah.
Do we want to say something like the sign height shall be verified by the building inspector?
What other items in the decision do you guys see?
Well, okay, we've talked about not approving the illuminated band on the canopy.
So that's pretty much under number three, it's everything but D. Portions of exposed fascia to be painted white.
Do you want to call it out as the illuminated red bar is not approved?
Well, we're not fans of the...
No signage or illumination of the canopy is approved.
Which again just leaves us with the white, adding the white to the...
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, that would change. Right, so you have to delete A, 4A, you have to delete 4B, and 4C. And then that last sentence should just say portions. Portions of the exposed space should be painted white, and they can paint whatever portion they want.
And that becomes number five.
5 or 4.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Or it's 4A. Is
4A is
four
okay.
Is okay.
Yeah.
We should mark up this drawing.
Yep.
If you have a clean copy, might as well scribble it.
And we'll have the stamp there for you, Jeff.
Okay.
Do you want to eliminate C on 6, canopy signage depicted, and just refer to the LED illumination?
Is that supposed to be, is that the one that was supposed to be SG2?
SG2 and SG3, but we're, and so
right.
Under 6 we're saying the following doesn't conform to
right.
Zoning.
Right, so yeah, delete
so
that.
You
yeah.
Don't even want C.
Right. The issue is for him, Jeff was just asking, what about, and I guess it comes up to you, is if we don't allow the illuminated red band, then you, we're guessing that you don't want to put the yellow fascia board on there, because then it's just, then it's...
I'm not sure of that.
All right.
There could be the possibility they would like to go with a different level of improvement, and they include this yellow...
Yellow and red or something like that, yeah.
But it would be non-illuminated.
Right.
So there's a possibility, maybe a hybrid.
In that case, Gene, if they're just, changing the fascia of the canopy, maybe creating a little, you know, yellow and red, new fascia panel or something, does that, that then doesn't become a sign?
No.
Right? And that doesn't need to go through this process, and
no.
Then you can go and don't necessarily come and have to come through this
correct
process to do that again.
Because it's yellow now.
Yeah.
Right. Well, a part of this improvement is the yellow fascia has
a little curve to it, yeah.
And then they have this three-dimensional red band that projects out. What they'd like to do is have it internally illuminated, and then it also has sort of a back light to the yellow fascia. I'm not sure, again, if my client would do the improvement without
the
red.
Yeah.
The internal illumination.
When the dimensional enhancement is not a problem. It's the illumination. You know, if they want to do something that's three-dimensional but static color, I mean, that's just a refacing, simple refacing.
Correct. Okay. So how do I want to reference that in this? I don't want to, I mean, are we saying it's not approved?
It's not part of this application.
Okay, that's fine.
As a sign.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
No, it says not approved.
Okay. Any other changes we see here?
Nope.
All right. Do we need to do a quick recap or anything? At the end of the day, we're...
We have what we need, Gene.
Anything good? Just to make sure we're on the same page. Nothing on the canopy is being approved. The freestanding sign, we're approving those changes. The only thing that may come into question is the height, which is going to be verified by the building inspector. And if it's determined that it is too high, it'll be part of your ZBA package. Is that everything?
I think so.
All right. Do we have a motion?
Move that the CPDC approve the minor modification of the master signage plan and issue a certificate of appropriateness as amended for the plan at 87 Walker's Brook Drive, the Shell Station.
Determine if this is a minor mod first. Do we have to vote on that?
I think we do.
Okay.
Can we go back? Sorry.
Leave that motion open.
Yep.
Right. Move that the CPDC determine that the proposed changes as amended for the signage plan at 87 Walker's Brook Drive constitute a minor modification.
Second.
All those in favor?
And the previous motion.
I'll second the previous motion.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Okay.
Thank you very much. Just one quick question. This
can, but I'll be at that meeting too.
That's fine. I just have a question that's always get asked. So I just want to be able to say.
They can do anything they want.
We recommend against it.
All right.
Thank you. Do you have the stamp, Gene?
Right there in front.
It's right there.
Okay.
Right in front of you.
All right. I left my house keys at home. I just gotta tell my wife to leave the door open. One second.
Where do you live, man?
All right. Where'd our No More in Maine friends go?
They took a break.
Okay. Next up on the agenda, minor modification request from 530 Main Street, Biltmore in Maine. Gene, you want to give us a quick overview?
So Biltmore in Maine, this was a minor mod that was before the board several months ago. They did all the work, and when I went down there a week or so ago to in advance of the sign-off for planning, it became apparent that there was an issue with the exterior lighting. And this is the chair's handiwork, which is pretty impressive, that shows the wall sconces on the outside have a bit of a problem with light spillage. So rather than hold them up from opening in the spirit of being business friendly, in consultation with the chair, we decided that we would let them get open with a conditional approval from planning that they would have to come back and talk to this board about ways to remedy this light spillage problem. That's why they're here.
Hi, good evening. I'm Gary Giannino, Henry Faraso, and Nicole Carroll. We did, as Jean's correct in her description of that day, in the original plans, there was a highlight of just replacing the light, and we were here talking about the front of the commission back then. We didn't even deal with that light. We just thought we were replacing seven lights with seven lights. When Gene made us aware of the fact that these lights did not meet the criteria, we went out to look to see if we could, we went to the manufacturer to see if we could get some sort of cap.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, they don't have such a cap. Then we went out to look to see if we could fabricate something, and that proved to be quite costly, more expensive than the fixtures themselves. What we'd like to do is replace the six, seven fixtures in the front. We have some pictures.
Yeah,
we do. Giving you just the package of some of the background.
Oh,
it's
okay.
So a little clear as to what the lights were in. So it's more information basically updated for tonight's meeting. What we'd like to do is replace those seven fixtures with the first one you can see is part of our seven or eight pages back.
So the old lantern?
A lantern. It's capped at the top, so the it talks to design to cast downward vision.
Isn't the issue really the fact this has a top to it? It has it just has a clear lens all around the bulb, and this will just have the same clear lens.
Well, it's not, it's open, the existing is open right now, right in here. So there is some spillage coming in here. This has a cap which protrudes out past. That was almost right level with the glass itself.
In the past, we've had this, all this glare has come from the front of the fixture, not so much the top. Although, is the top what's causing the main portion of the sign to white out? Or is it just a part of that?
It's not causing the main sign to white out. It was just the fact that it wasn't, the dark sky provision, we were not aware of that at the time.
So yeah, when I went down there, that's what I saw. This is my picture, and I felt like the light was kind of shining upwards, as well as obviously pointing down. So I thought that might be a concern of the board, and asked that we take a look at that.
I would have just taken a piece of black galvanized stovepipe and wrapped it around the top of that fixture with one set of screws.
I mean, that's what we had a machinist look at it, try to build us a cap. You know what I mean? Like a hat that kind of like snapped on the back.
It's kind of round the top.
It's cast iron, so you can't really weld to it. And just it's got that corrugated shape. It's not, I mean, as far as what we are asked to do, that doesn't really, it's not that easy. And these were not that simple, you know, not hundreds of dollars, they were a couple hundred. You know, spend another couple hundred trying to put something on top. So I think we would rather buy another fixture that you're happier with than go through all that trouble. And this, you know, we can get this and put it up. That kind of thing is going to take weeks to even get made, and then we have to have something installed. So it seems more of a hassle, and we'd almost rather just swap them out and be done with it, I think.
I do like the light.
Yeah.
It's a nice light.
This is a good light.
We'll find something to do with it somewhere else.
Yeah.
We were complaining that this team brought up. We understood the concern, and we're just trying to get
I'm just trying not to let design get in the way of this. You really happy with this fixture compared to this one with everything you've done to the building?
No, we're happier with the first one. Obviously. I mean, we're happy. Like, that's the picture we picked. Like, one of those. Yeah, we're sort of going back with the almost a nicer version of the picture that was on the building
there
before.
Yeah.
Is it because you were trying to wrap the outer portion of it, or were you trying to just wrap around the glass?
I think the confusion we have is, you know, do you put a cylindrical flat cap over it so the light doesn't go up, or are you building a lampshade out of steel to go around it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
One, you can just kind of slide a disc on there, but aesthetically it kind of looks looks awkward,
but
if we can put a...
Just something that wrapped the glass. For 3 or 4 inches, right?
Sort of takes away from what the effect of the fixture is trying to do.
I mean, what we have in there now is a 40-watt Einstein bulb, which is like the lowest bulb you can get, you know, for the front. I think that the ones we took down, we still have the bulbs in them. They were 100-watt LED, so it was completely different, you know. They're
much softer
now,
and also we have, you know, we've got the metal halide street lights.
Oh, so you've changed them since that picture? That was like day 2.
Also, that picture just, you know, in real life, it's not like that. In real life, they're soft, glowing lights. That's like the, you know, it's making everything look very glary.
I'm not sure, Janet, if once you change the bulb, probably that cup tell you that character of the 40. I do know if we walked out there tonight with the 40, it's not that bright.
Sure. Yeah, no, look, guys, I don't want to give you guys a hard time about this. I think you guys have done an outstanding job with this property. A lot of it is also precedent. Don't want to necessarily allow something in one instance because that'll come back to bite us in another.
Sure.
So just want to make sure we're covered from that angle. Yeah, that's what, see?
That's ugly.
That's ugly.
Right. and that's what they had, 100-watt LED in there, so it was like just a,
yeah.
At eye height, that was kind of like a spotlight in your face as you walked by.
Our contractor took a moment to say you were going to use
them. I wanted to just go over, just real quick, because we did present this before, and I guess because Jesse's gone, something happened. Because we didn't purchase our fixture until we came to our meeting. So we thought it was tripped before we purchased it, based on this meeting before, so I'm not sure what happened.
I think the decisions always say Dark Skies Initiative. I don't have the decision with me, so it might not have been a problem with the fixture. But when I look back on the decision, I didn't see as part of the approval exterior lighting.
In the writing and wording? Or
correct.
I think our discussion, I remember being here that night, we talked about the third sign in the parking lot. We took that down. And we talked about the blade sign.
Yeah.
And actually the back. So we spent up, and then we talked about the prop lights that were there.
Yeah.
Right.
Goosenecks. Really
I went back over the plans. There were no plans that talked about
the
light
fixtures. There's so many details to work through.
You might have had the fixture in the packet, but it didn't talk about specifically.
Yeah, it was a photo of that with the details.
It's on page 4. That's the
official.
It wasn't approved as the minor modification.
So yeah, I mean, my hope was that you could somehow take what you put up there and add some sort of wrap around it or something. That's too bad you can't do that without shilling out a lot of money.
The fixture, you would think the top was closed then.
Yeah.
Are you saying that light is actually spilling up through the top shell of this?
No, but it's
parallel to the light. I think that's the only.
It has a top on it, obviously, but it's just where the light bulb is in the picture, I guess, you know?
Yeah.
And maybe that style of glass, you know, that old school leaded glass that kind of reflects the light in a different way than a normal.
Yeah. And it's not like shining straight up, which obviously is what we're trying to prevent.
Right.
But there is some light spilling upwards. Whether
or
not it's going to impact dark sky compliance, probably not.
Yeah.
Don't have to buy the ugly new ones. It obviously would be better.
Well, personally, I would give them a pass on it and let them go with what they got.
Mm-hmm.
As long as we deal with maybe we want to limit the lumens.
Take down the bulbs. Take the bulbs way down.
Well,
what did you say was
interesting? I thought you said
it's right now we have 40 watt.
40-watt, what, LED?
No, Einstein bulb, so it's Edison bulb. It's the old school.
Regular incandescent.
Can you bring up my picture one more time?
It actually gives out less light than regular.
I mean, you can go down to a 25-watt appliance bulb.
I think if I may, I remember at the beginning we had some different watt bulbs. I don't know if that's the same.
That one was
quite
a lot.
Right.
Less bright,
right.
Dimmer. Would, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. The one on the right hand side is the look. Somebody had put the clear, clear 60 watt bulb. You know, when they're like a contractor, we just had somebody put them up. And then once we realized, at night we walked across the street and looked, and we have, you know, I mean, these aren't even the light bulbs that are supposed to go in here, so we switched them to the Edison bulbs to make sure they all match all the way around.
I think I put that in my little call out there that I think I was okay with that. I don't remember what it says, but
that's what's up there right now, 40 all the way around. All seven have the same.
I'd be open to letting them try the 40, and if we don't like that one, go down to a 25, and then if that didn't work, they could swap out the fixture, and they could do that administratively.
Right.
Sure.
I just like this fixture so much better than the other one.
We appreciate that.
I'd still be trying to modify it. You know, that's what I would do before I gave up on it. I'd go down in wattage, and then I'd try to modify this, because it's just so nice.
I mean, part of my confusion is trying to which one we're trying to modify. You know what I mean? Like we're going to make a circle or a hat or
I think
a light.
Semicircle across the front will take all the glare off the street side and push the light to the back of the wall, and that would probably take it down a lot with a lower bulb. I'm trying to think of which restaurant it was. You know, I think it was...
Well, or the other thing is, if you used one of the...
Can someone take a look at the lower wattage that we have in there?
Yeah, I could drive by there on the way home.
Yeah, but even if you went with like the 40 watt, the mini reflector, the kind of thing that you find in the track lighting.
Oh, you
which
could put a power bulb in there with its
yeah.
flood,
like
small flood, so that all the lights coming down. Yeah,
oh, so
yeah, they'd have
straight
to.
Down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I could try that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I would.
Yeah,
I'd be open to letting them try a couple bulbs
yeah.
before we
sure.
give up on the fixture.
That'd be great.
Okay, we'll do that. We'll deal with Gene.
Yeah, I'll get my planning staff right on it. Oh, wait, that's me.
Well, you know what? Just send me an email and I'll drive by it every time they change it and we'll check
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Give you my opinion on it.
I mean, our goal is.
Jeff's kids are now in that role, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like my kids and me. Tony, you had a comment or question?
Tony Drezzo, 130 John Street. Oh, what about the blade sign that's currently up in play?
Like
that was approved, yes.
Yeah.
That was approved.
I didn't think we allowed blade signs to be lit in town, especially with a neon type.
It's not neon.
We permitted that one because the option was to have an external light on it. And then we just figured that from the slope, you'd actually see the fixture, whereas this one's sort of inside the rim of that. And we thought that was a better solution. That was our, it was our suggestion to
my only fear is how many other cities in town are going to start putting up electronic blade signs.
Lit blade signs.
Well, the blade signs are allowed to have a spotlight.
Yes, they are.
Well, then you'd see the flood, which is worse. To be driving up Main Street and have a floodlight on the opposite, because they're going to light both sides, right? So then you're going to see
how bright they light.
You know, it's nicer to have the light inside the frame and be more subtle.
The real challenge with...
I have to go look at it.
Tony, the real challenge with this particular location is because you're coming up.
Yeah.
If you're driving up or walking up the hill, no matter how you set the lights on there, you're at some point
it's going to be
right in your eyes, which is really the big
it's not internally illuminated. It has a light on the outside of a solid panel.
It's halo, isn't it?
It's a halo.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. To me it looks more neon like, as though
no.
it was actually
no. adding up. No, that's just a glow. It's not internally illuminated.
No.
We
allow halo in business space.
Or is it just the B and the M, or I don't remember all the discussion. I think we talked about either doing halo for the logo portion of it, or putting the light in the case, right?
Yeah.
Looks like it's in a cloud. That's the look you get standing right in front of us.
Mm-hmm.
Really
mm-hmm.
does.
Okay, so.
All right, so I don't think we have to approve anything. If you want to work with Gene.
Well, we can take, nice camera, we'll take pictures.
It sounds like you've already made the changes,
pictures.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right now, when you can look at it, it's not in the already doing
Yep.
right now, so I think it's all, you know.
Yeah.
And I think from our standpoint too, because of the streetlight, it's, they're decorative fixtures.
Yeah, yeah, they're not meant to provide any sort of lighting function.
It's kind of an individual pretty thing at this point, it's not that functional as a light fixture, so it almost doesn't matter to us what light bulb.
Okay.
Okay.
No.
Nothing necessary.
I don't think so.
Do we wanna vote on whether fall else fails, they're gonna swap it out with a fixture? Do we care right now what that fixture is?
I would prefer if they don't swap it out.
I know, I agree.
But so I don't think we need to do anything right now.
I would suggest this, and if well everyone's here, is we go through the path of the bulbs. If that doesn't work, Gene can bring that back to us. The same material will hold the same material, and we can go and approve the one. That way, you guys aren't being hauled in here, and we can go through that. But less paperwork, less hassle if we just sort of work through the first couple of steps first. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Because we don't, I know you guys don't want to come here, so we've done it once already, so or for this one. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much.
All right.
We're happy to see our first week of business has been brisk.
Good.
You're quite welcome.
I was in there on Saturday. We had a real nice time. It was great.
Great.
So thank you.
Appreciate it.
Yeah,
sure.
Thanks, folks. Have a good one.
You know how to reach me.
All right. Let's keep going.
Yep.
All right. So we are out. Planning updates and other business. So we've got Pizza World.
Yes. We were told that there was going to be some paperwork filed by not the current owner, but the previous owner, Tyree, with regard to the closeout of the site, the environmental component. And so we wanted to make the board aware that there was, there was some closeout activity pending. That has not happened. So I really don't have a lot to report. Pizza World, as part of its approval from CPDC as well as conservation, was asked to have a recovery action plan in place in the event that they, during construction, if they did have some issue with contaminated soils or something. You know, what do you do and how do you contain it? So it was really a plan that would be a worst case scenario to follow if there was a problem once they started construction. And there was some concern from the business owner that would be a little bit burdensome. But we had talked about it here, and it's sort of a standard protocol, in my estimation, with sites like this. And conservation is very concerned and has it as part of their protocol. So we're trying to work through this. It's kind of sticky. And I'm hoping that we can get it done and get the project going, because as it stands right now, it hasn't been provided, and so it's going to essentially stall the project. I'm hoping to have a little better news the next couple of meetings.
Yeah, we wanted to get moving / keep moving, but it is immediately adjacent to the whatever it is, Brook.
Walker's Brook, I think
it
is,
yeah. The other side of Main Street.
Mm-hmm.
I had somebody ask me about Perfectos. Any further movement?
I can't explain. I'm at a loss for words.
So were the people across the street.
Just moving slow? Is that?
The last time I checked, which was a while ago, but they hadn't even pulled any electrical or plumbing permits.
Okay.
Now that, I've been off the grid for a little bit, so maybe it's has happened, but every time I go by, I don't see activity.
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea why.
Spurts.
Yeah.
You see a good month of pretty solid activity, and then it'll disappear.
Yep, I have no idea.
Yeah. All right. Valerie's Bridal?
Yes, so 258 Main Street. You might recall we were before you like over 2 years ago,
mm-hmm.
with a very contemporary commercial building. This was the, I think it was going to be the one of the first demo delays under the 6-month demolition delay change that happened a few years ago. Well, it turns out they're back. And because it's more than 2 years, they were issued a, they went through the whole process of demolition delay. They were issued a demolition permit, and now the permit has expired because it's more than 2 years old. So they have to go through the entire process all over again for demolition delay permit, or to get their demolition permit.
Mm-hmm.
And so the property owner, there were two guys, now it's just one. The project is somewhat revised. We haven't even had a DRT on it yet, but I wanted to let the board know that it's coming. And they've got a little more work to do on the site plan, but the big issue is the delay.
So it was, if I remember, it was a fairly, I'm going to say, a design that was a departure from,
yes,
from typical colonial style stuff that we see. Is that still,
in my opinion,
in,
yes, it's not the same design, but it's still a departure, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, the, I mean, the site has challenges in terms of the terrain.
Yes,
yeah,
yeah,
that's right.
Absolutely.
Grade change and so forth.
They did take the CPDC's recommendations to look at combining with some of the other parcels around them, so I think there may be some assembly of additional parcels, but I'm not sure where that is. But they were talking about that, which would be good and give them more of an enlarged site. So.
Good. Any other updates?
The only other thing I wanted to mention, we have a couple of meetings coming up. Wednesday night is the public forum number 3 for the Economic Development Action Plan we've been working on with MAPC. The meeting starts at 6:30. And they have a light dinner. It's going to be at RMLD in the cafeteria, which is in the back. And you can come in through the back. So it has its own separate entrance and everything. You come up to a deck and then go in that way. And it's going to be stations. So there'll be mostly an opportunity to visit all the, there's one sort of catch-up station for people who haven't been to any of the meetings. And then there are 5 stations that you can go and make comments about different aspects of the plan. There's some strategies that are associated with the plan for kind of how we get there. And so it'll be more or less a workshop type of meeting as opposed to presentation and talking and all that. So I wanted to remind the board, I posted the meeting as CPDC, so you're all posted for the meeting if you go and if you talk, feel free, you're all good. And then the other meeting is the following Wednesday, so that's October 7th, so October 14th is the public hearing for the revised plan presented by Criterion. That's for 186 Summer Ave. And that's the school that's going into Summer Ave. They're now proposing a different plan that would use an underground tunnel,
mm-hmm.
and refurbish the barn.
The What's the context? I mean, the Wednesday is not one of our meeting nights. I mean.
No, I'm just mentioning it because they're both kind of big meetings.
It's historic, it's a historic district.
Historic District Commission, sorry.
Okay.
Yep.
So that's, will be in this building or?
No, I think it's at Coolidge. Coolidge Middle School, if I got that right, yeah. We have some historical folks here.
So, last time around, that went to us first and then Historic District second. And now it's going the other direction. I assume if they make, I mean, there's gonna be different changes to the site plan, so it will eventually come before us. Was there a rhyme or reason for doing it that way, or they just keep dealing with the Historic District because that's, because they were in that mode?
Yeah, I think it's a continuation of where they were, but I'll defer to the Chair of the Historical Commission. Maybe, have you got any more? They're right next door, okay. Yeah, I think that's what it is. I think there was, they've got to a certain point and they've been working with the HDC all these weeks and months, and now they're coming back with something different. So I think that's why it's with HDC first, and then I assume it'll come back to CPDC.
Yeah, I'm not sure they'll change their parking very much.
I don't think they're changing their parking at all.
That's what I mean.
My understanding, the parking system.
38 spots?
So what change is there for us?
There's still, there's gotta be some site plan difference from what they approved, the sidewalks. There's not a building. The footprint of the building is gonna be different, so.
Right, but
Putting an addition on, right?
I'm not sure it'll be substantial changes, but it will be a different site plan.
It'll be a different plan, yeah.
I'm thinking that their parking lot edges pretty much went around the southern perimeter of the buildings. The barn wasn't moving.
Right.
Right.
Right,
and so I don't see them changing any of that.
I would agree.
There's just no building where.
Yeah.
Well, I guess the old part of the building is still there.
Mm-hmm.
Versus the new piece they were putting up in its place.
Right.
Maybe some lighting, but I bet you the parking's the same. They won't give up parking spaces.
Do they still need that many? If they're not gonna have as many classrooms?
Are they not gonna have as many classrooms? Who said that?
Oh, we don't know.
We don't know.
I thought we did know. I don't know. That's a check. Do you happen to know if they're gonna have more classrooms or fewer classrooms?
I thought they were gonna have the same number of rooms, but maybe not quite the capacity. I'm not really sure.
Okay.
Okay.
No.
That's.
I understood there were maybe two classrooms now.
I think last time they had four, so, oh, well.
Yeah.
We'll find out. Okay. Anything else, Gene?
That's pretty much it.
Sounds good. Is there anything you wanted to stay or ask or?
Our interest was the 258 Main Street.
Oh, okay.
I don't know, Gene, if you can share plans that you have.
We haven't fully reviewed the plans. The next step is to have a DRT meeting, which we've scheduled. But the plans are in the office. Are you saying that you would want to look at them?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're in the office.
What is that DRT?
I just got the email today.
We'll probably get it.
No, we talked about the need to go back through the process, and I haven't heard from them since. Their attorney was on vacation, so I think that's why there's been a week or two, a little bit of a lull. And I think that's why we're making the DRT so far out. It's 2 or 3 weeks out. Here it is. October 21st at 9 a.m. in the conference room. We haven't even distributed the packets yet, but she just scheduled the meeting.
Thank you.
All right. If there's nothing else, do we want to knock out these meeting minutes?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I I went through them and found nothing.
I have a question about the top of page two, second paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of goes back to the paper store discussion when we've already moved on to the OIA's discussion.
Yeah, they commented because they
yeah.
said that they needed, that if OIA's didn't get like permitted, they would need to move the structure. So they kind of jumped in at the end of the OIA's discussion for a minute.
Okay.
Yeah, that was, I think it was just a commentary.
Okay.
The other thing I saw, pretty minor, is it Kristen or Krista? I saw it, Kristen Rodriguez in the others present, and then
I think
first.
It's Kristen.
Okay, so just want to fix that. Under public hearing for accessory
oh,
structure.
Okay.
Yeah.
And page three, under planning updates, one, two, three, third sentence, it says, the wall would not hold up and it is not, probably it did not.
John?
Yep, good.
All right.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of September 14th, 2015 as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Move it to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor? Thanks, guys.